Dr. Brown's a distinguished professor of operations research and the executive director of the Center for Infrastructure Defense at the Naval Postgraduate School. He's been teaching for many, many years and has been applying operations research to a broad range of military problems and also in support of Fortune 50 companies. So with that, I won't spend as much time introducing Dr. Brown today, but we're honored to have him here to speak to us again.
Hi, everybody. It's flattering to be here today with you, and it's hard to imagine. I used to be as young and smart as you guys. Not only that, but good looking too. You guys really look sharp in your uniforms. Makes me proud. I'm here today to talk about operations research in the real world, which rules out about 95% of all professors in this business. The background of this presentation, full disclosure, this was a plenary address that was made in Nashville, Tennessee, to the Informs organization. It's available on my website for download, less all the animations, which are fragile on some computers. This is 50 years of my career learning how not to do operations research, things to avoid. There are some things here that aren't in any textbook, but I fervently suggest that they are worthy of your attention. And so I want to walk you through how we do operations research with the goal of influencing policy. Taxpayers are not giving you an OR degree so that you can have fun with mathematics or build algorithms. They're not spending a degree in operations research at the Naval Postgraduate School is a great gift from the taxpayers. It's worth nearly $500,000. If you don't ask for it from your detailer, by the way, you won't get it. Get free housing, free health care, and it's the only time in your military career you'll be told don't do anything else except be a student. We own you 48 weeks a year, and we're going to grind you. So, part of operations research, as the six teams today did a grand job of explaining to us, part of operations research is you don't always get to give the boss good news. So you got to be prepared sometimes to tell the boss the truth in a way that's convincing and honest, but not necessarily pleasing. So why are you in OR? Well, you guys chose OR as a profession. You like math? I do. You like designing algorithms? I'm really fond of that. I did that shortest path thing yesterday. That was kind of fun. Shortest path method taught me by my horse. You like to solve puzzles? Yeah, that works. Think it's cool to be called professor? Remember, this address was to be for a room full of 850 professors, all right? Do you think it's really cool someone has to call you professor all the time? Or do you want to influence policy? Well, I'm here to tell you today and try to convince you what you should be doing at all times is focusing all your attention on working on important problems, solving them well, explaining the solutions so that your leadership can understand them, because you're likely not going to be the decision maker, you're going to be the persuader, and you want to influence policy. I'm fortunate to have been elected to the National Academy of Engineering. As a consequence, I've been asked to serve on the Navy Studies Board, the Air Force Studies Board, the Army Studies Board. I've been asked to testify on the Hill, and I have access to the Hill. We have a legislative branch of NAE, which is there to arrange for us to get to committee staffers when we find something that's really worrisome to us. And that does occur on occasion at the Naval Postgraduate School. Things happen, and you go, uh-oh, we need to worry about this. I need to get the Armed Services Committee worried about this. And it's typically the staffers you talk to, not the congressmen. This is for a civilian audience, but I think it's worth us remembering by looking in a mirror what we're about here. So what do we do? How many of you know what the Bretton Woods Accords are? Oh, got your notebooks? There's a book called Accidental Superpower. Accidental Superpower cost you $14 on Amazon. It's a great read. It's written 5 years ago with some very improbable predictions, all of which have come true. It's written by a demographer, geographer, very unusual view of the world. He starts his history with the Egyptian civilization and continues it through today. But he points out that the Bretton Woods Accords occurred in 1944 during World War II. Bretton Woods is an obscure hotel in Vermont. The United States invited at gunpoint all of our allies to send representatives to a meeting that took place. As a result of this meeting, we came up with international currency accords, which were in place until about 8 years ago. And we came up with an agreement in which we agreed that the U.S. Navy, after the war, the U.S. Navy would protect all sea lanes worldwide from any harm, and no one had to pay a cent, and no one had to worry about it or do anything. And that's what we've done since then. We agreed to be the policemen of the seas. This has led to 70 years the longest epoch of peaceful relations among international partners in the history of the world. So if you think about it, 70 years without a major war. This is due to the Bretton Woods Accord. I'm afraid to say, as of today, I'm not sure the Navy can afford Bretton Woods for another 5 years. We either go to distributed lethality and a lot larger numbers of smaller ships and other unpopular things on the Hill, or we're in trouble. We just can't stretch ourselves any thinner. Okay, so this is, again, who's the Naval Postgraduate School? Well, what do? We have naval officers, typically after the first couple of tours. They come back for graduate school, and as I mentioned, you get free housing, free food, free health care with your family. It's your duty. Monterey's not a shabby place to be. We've got 18 golf courses. You'll not have any time to use them, but we have 18 golf courses you can admire. In OR, we do military OR, which is different than civilian OR, very different. We are a trusted source of analysis for the government. They own us. We work for the government. Most of us have clearances. I have an admiral I work for that has his hand around my throat. So, and we're a lot cheaper than Beltway bandits. So a lot of work comes to us as a point of first refusal. Can you work on this project? What do you know about aviation scheduling? We've been able to influence over $1 trillion of investments, missile systems, ships. They come to us to decide how many of this class of ship do we need to provide this level of coverage. And we managed to save lives. You, in a civilian school, might do network analysis. Quite popular. Almost everybody's had such a class. At the Naval Postgraduate School, we might be interested in degrading the network or destroying the network. It's a very different class of models. We might be concerned that someone else could degrade or destroy our network. So we like to play offense, but since 9/11, the rules have been changed that allow me to play defense, too. So I'm able to work with the Department of Homeland Security and with various agencies, state agencies typically, on developing plans for things like evacuations and inundations and responding to national disasters or, worse yet, terrorist attacks. I'll give you two examples of the sorts of applications we get involved in. One of them is called the replenishment at sea model, which this young man here helped invent. The idea is to increase operational presence around the world of the U.S. Navy. I'll explain why in a moment. And the other one is the air tasking model for the U.S. Air Force, and I present this because it's a purple model. This is where we're working for all the services at once. When our students go through the OR curriculum, when they graduate, we give them a money-back guarantee. If any problem comes up in the future that you think we queried when we were in class with you, give us a call, and we'll show up and help you if we can. This was a money-back guarantee problem. We were able to save some lives, I'll show you. So the replenishment sea planner is currently in use in more than half of the world. It operates worldwide, and we cannot assume access to port facilities, nor can we assume that we allow ships to take them offline to put them in port, to do port calls. Sometimes it's better if we keep them operating, keep their presence up. To do that, we're the only Navy, although the Chinese have learned this, and they're getting better at it, we have been historically the only Navy that can sustain itself deployed at sea by doing underway replenishments. They need to have fuel and ordnance and dry stores. They need to have mail. They need to have movies, right? But what we have is a bunch of customers moving around, our operators. These are our combatants, not only our combatants, but our coalition partner combatants. Coalition partnerships, some of them, we have to give them potable water. They can't make their own water, as U.S. ships can. So we go to our ships and find them. Now, if you're an OR type, what we have is customers all over the world moving around at various speeds, and we have a fleet of combat logistics force ships. They're going to try to track them down. So what you have is a multiple traveling salesman problem with moving customers and time windows. This is not an easy problem to solve. We co-opted Google Earth as our animator. It turns out Google Earth has the ability to run animations and movies. And so our solutions are graphical solutions, and the Commodores love this. They may not see all the details, but they can come in and they can see for the next 14 days, here's where all your actors are and here's what they'll be doing. And you can zoom and do all the things you can do with Google Earth. Now, if I were a scheduler and I was scheduling CLF ships to steam around and catch my customers, what do you suppose a symptom of a mistake would be? What sort of a mistake could happen? Okay, or suppose, it never happens, of course, but suppose a combatant has new orders and is not where I expected it to be. One thing. Suppose I just made a computational mistake as a planner. What degrees of freedom do I have to respond to having made a mistake? If I, I've got a mistake here. 6 days out, I got a guy who's going to run low on fuel. I got to go get him. What do I have to do? My assets are my CLF ships. I can pick up a radio. I can send messages to them, satellite messages. What do I tell these guys to do? Change course? Yeah. Well, what else? And typically, what's the only degree of freedom I have? If I'm running these ships optimally, they're very, very busy. The only degree of freedom I have is to speed them up. What happens when you speed up a ship? Fuel consumption goes up. Fuel consumption, sadly, goes up super linearly. In fact, it goes up quadratically. So if I double a ship's speed to respond to a mistake, I increase its fuel consumption per hour by a factor of 3 to 4. This is not good. As a consequence, whenever we have a CLF ship on our little graphical user interface here, if it's moving at faster than its most efficient speed, it shows up in orange. If it's moving at a very inefficient speed, it shows up in red. Guess what the Commodore is looking for when he looks at this? We are now operating in, by the way, Walt, we're operating in 3rd Fleet as of last week, 5th Fleet and 7th Fleet, so that's more than a hemisphere of the ocean. That's where about 65 to 70% of the world's population is, and where most of the trouble is, and many the majority of disasters take place. This is pretty sporty seamanship. You're going along at 10 knots, that's a 9,000-ton vessel, and you're hooking up lines to a supply ship, and it concentrates your mind on the bridge if you've been through one of these exercises. By the way, I know I've got rotor heads in the room here, so I have to say that the vert reps that take place at the same time can also be pretty sporty in various sea states. So that's what we do with CLF. The result is, I'm not allowed to say exactly, we had independent auditors audit 5th Fleet and 7th Fleet for the last quarter of last year. And the number I will not give you, but I can say that we save more money than the Naval Postgraduate School costs. Okay. So air tasking. I got a call from an ex-student. He says, sir, I need your help. I've tried to formulate this. I can't get it right. There's something broken. You got to help. This was during OIF, Operation Iraqi Freedom. And this was the U.S. Air Force, and the Air National Guard was running a fleet of C-130s, C-17s, actually some chartered Russian IL-76s, and a handful of C-5s. We had a fleet of about 50 aircraft moving all over the theater, moving pallets of equipment and moving personnel. And my student had called and said, sir, there's something wrong here. There's empty seats in these planes. He had known from my class, one of the examples I use in linear programming class is the example of when we scheduled United Airlines. He said, if you schedule United Airlines with all those planes, couldn't you schedule these Air Force planes? We said, well, we'll give it a try. So we went over to the Defense Language Institute in Monterey and got about 50 inoculations and went down to Lemoore to get weapons qualifications. We got fitted with a go-to-war suit, battle rattle. I had to take somebody else with me. I talked my boss, Rob Dell, into going. Our main job was to try to do better at getting more cargo and more efficiency out of the fleet, but those empty seats we could put troops in. And if we have troops flying around at night, they're not getting blown up in convoys. So the bottom line was, can we get these guys off the ground? So this is a call from an Army student to fly to an Army base in Kuwait to help the Air Force. So this is purple. And everybody had to agree that there was a problem, which is not always easy, and everybody had to agree that maybe we could help them work from the Navy. Hello. One requirement, I went to General Schwartz, who was running Scott Air Force Base at the time. He was later on the Chief of Staff. I said, we haven't got a lot of time. I need transportation. So he gave me a jet. I always remind my boss this. My boss is the guy on the right there, Rob Dell. He was carrying my bags, so. That's Rob Dell in the back of a C-17, just for scale. The way these work is we have pallet loads that go into, there's two tracks of pallets in C-17s, a single track and 130s. We have seats in C-17s that we can remove or put in, so we have some flexibility. With the 130s, if you've been in them before, they have hammock seats that you can put down or take up. So we have some flexibility about configurations. Oops. That's our unclassified airfield. All these flights are conducted at night, have been conducted at night. They're all conducted with night vision goggles, amazingly enough, with monocular night vision goggles until recently. Try flying with one eye closed, even in the daytime. We visit all these fields to do time and motion studies. This is done at night, lights out, engines running. And when you're putting cargo and personnel on and off the tarmac, and there's interesting things going on in the neighborhood, it's a high-risk affair. I grew to really admire the Air National Guard guys. They flew every night, all night. The wrench turners slept with the airplanes in the sand. They didn't even go 2 miles to go to their quarters, their tents. They slept with the airplanes. They're really dedicated. It's pretty gratifying when you get a letter from a general 4 months later and he says, thanks for fixing things. I can't tell you by how much, but we increased lift a lot. And they did some modeling and said, you saved X casualties and Y KIAs. Thank you. As a consequence of that, that's why I was awarded the Navy Distinguished Service Medal. Okay, let's track the consequences of all these projects we get involved in. And students here, you'll see there's a lot of senior people here that get along. You know, there's professors and so forth. We get involved in a lot of projects, a lot of problems. The immediate consequences of these things that we solve are exceedingly rare. Intermediate term consequences, rare. Basically, what I'm telling is, it's a rare event. It's a lightning stroke when we solve a problem and it actually ends up doing something important. And typically that's our fault because we chose the wrong problem or we chose the wrong client or we chose the wrong technique. So what I want to walk you through is an algorithm of how not to step into these potholes that I've developed painfully over a career approaching 50 years. So if you track the consequences of what we do, it's really our fault. Because we're scholars. We're not trained to influence policy. We're not Ivy League types. We're mathematicians. We're engineers. I don't care what type of analysis. If you like simulation, I like simulation. Optimization, fine. I don't care what the analysis tool is that you use, even common sense. These rules transcend all of these. I don't care if you're doing descriptive modeling or normal. It doesn't matter. These are the mistakes that I've made. The goal is influencing policy. That's why we're being paid to do all this. That's why all of you have TDY orders to be here today. That's the ultimate reason you're here. Okay, how are you going to solve the problem? That's usually the first thing you worry about is an OR, right? Is this a networks problem? Is this a linear program? Is it a simulation problem? As soon as you hear about it, right? 5 minutes in, someone says, hey, I'm worried about something. How are you going to solve it? No, that's not the first thing you should do. First thing you have to do is determine what the problem is. Now I'm going to expand each of these, you'll see 5 points here. I'm going to expand each of these 5 points into a series of sub-bullets to explain what I mean by that. But the first thing you need to do is get the problem definition straight. 4 of the 6 teams today would have had been well advised to do that. Get the problem straight first. Determine why this problem is important and worthy of money being spent on it. I don't think there's a problem that we solve that we don't invest a couple $100,000 with the taxpayer money on. And some of these problems that have been brought to us, it may be important to the guy that brought it to you because it's an annoyance to him, but if you're not going to be able to save any money or you're just going to make him feel better because some analysis was done, that's not a worthy reason to solve the problem. How is the problem being solved today? Whiteboard and Crayola is an excellent decision support tool. Little magnetic tiles. If you go into any place that does planning, any logistics cell, any air ops office, anywhere, that problem is being solved by very clever people with very good thumb rules. And when they make mistakes, they've been rapped on the knuckles for it. And it's a good idea to find out how they're solving the problem. And despite the fact they're solving the problem, why does somebody think it's still a problem? Ah, now that's the part you want to talk about, right? If you satisfy these first three qualifications, then it might be time to say, okay, I think I've got an important problem. I think I've got it described so I can understand it, so the client understands it. I know how it's being solved now. I can see that's a mistake. What am I going to do? One more step. When are you going to want to stop? How are you going to define success or failure? You don't get to define this after the fact. You have to define it before the fact. Exactly where is the bar? If you reach across that bar, you're a success, and if you don't, you're a failure, and you have to admit you're going to declare a failure. Stop the bleeding. Yes, I've been involved in projects that have been outright failures. Those don't lead to publications. They don't lead to fame and fortune. But you just want to stop the bleeding early so you can go do something more important. Okay, what is the problem? I'm going to go back and expand that first bullet. The client never, ever gives you an unambiguous problem statement, ever. What they'll describe to you is symptoms or annoyances or suspicions or jealousies. They're doing this with less people. How come he has $100,000 left in his Optar? But they won't tell you what the problem is. That's on you as an analyst. So the client uses his own vernacular. It may be improper. It may not actually be in English language Webster's dictionary. They use their own developed vernacular for each service is a little different. Each part of each service is a little different. Each stovepipe is different. What you have to do is work with the client to develop a lexicon and agree with the client, okay, this is my dictionary. These are the terms I'm going to use. These are the definitions. Are we agreed? And henceforth, never write a document that has a word in it that's not in that lexicon. I know it sounds boring. It's not literate. It's boring, but it's precise. Often the problem hasn't been isolated, but its symptoms are evident. Okay. Sometimes this is the last step you take in an analysis. I think you may have seen that on occasion in military analysis shops. It should always be the first step. When it's the last step, it's very risky. You may find out at the end you solved the wrong thing. Okay, why is this problem important? Is this problem worthy of your time? It's a serious question. What's the cost of ignoring the problem? I guess the most frequent thing I've been asked to do is schedule Navy airplanes. Okay, if I schedule Navy airplanes, first of all, that's not constitutional because the Air Force is the only service that has scheduled airplanes, right? The Navy only is allowed to have airplanes if they're not scheduled. Secondly, if I schedule Navy airplanes, I got to know where the admirals are going and why. I got to have their manifests. Oh, there's golf clubs in there. Oh, their spouses went. Oh, okay, we don't have to schedule it. Who owns the solution? The guy suffering the symptoms may not have the ability to solve the problem. If you don't identify who owns the solution before you start, you're working with no client. Sometimes this determining a problem importance and leverage is the last thing that you do, and that's embarrassing. How is the problem solved now? These problems are being addressed every day. It's very rare someone brings you a brand new problem that hasn't already been solved, isn't being solved. Thumb rules, marker pens, whiteboards, all kinds of tools like that are very effective. The first thing we try to do is if there's a cell that's solving a problem is you visit the cell. And the first thing you want to do is look for everything that's posted visibly. That's why if it's unclassified, you use your iPhone. Otherwise, you have to get special permission, get some images. What's on post-it notes? Now open the drawers. What's in the drawers? Here's binders. What's in the binders? Okay. Do you have a list of phone numbers? Who are the phone numbers to? Do you have a list of email addresses, CIPRnet addresses? You follow me? I want to get inside the scheduler's head. What does this guy need within arm's reach to deal with this problem every day successfully, even though I've been told we can do better? Tribal wisdom is very effective. Does the solution change the problem? I'll get back to that again in a minute. You may propose a solution that actually moves the problem into someone else's court, and that may be a good thing. If someone else happens to be the Chinese, then it may be a bad thing. Are there domain limits of acceptable solutions? There's things that we can control, and there's the laws of physics. Sometimes this is the last step, and that's too bad. Okay, how are you going to solve the problem? This is fun. This is where we get through this is where we get to flex our muscles as ORs. It's the fun part. It's not the only part of qualifying a problem, and it's not the first part, it's not the last part, but it's the fun part. Is the path to solution clear dominantly, or is this brand new ground? Does this give you pause? Have you got the grit to do it? Do you have the training in your background? If you're going to use something familiar rather than something appropriate, not a good idea. If there are people who are domain experts that you know are better than you are at this, get their advice. That doesn't mean you have to ask them to do the job, but make sure they're looking over your shoulder and giving you an honest critique up front so you don't commit yourself to something where you're over your head. And once again, don't make this the last step. Well, how will we know when you've succeeded? We have to set the bar for success ahead of time. Can't decide afterwards. Be wary of anybody moving the bar on you. I hate that when I think I've done it right. And they say, yeah, but how about 10% more? Up or down, I don't care. If they make it easier, I'm suspicious. If they make it harder, I'm suspicious. Again, Okay. What are the reasons not to brief an optimal solution? I'm an optimizer. I've got an optimal solution here, and I go, no. This is not going to fly. What might some reasons be not to brief an optimal solution? Is the why of the solution as clear as the what? Can you connect the dots for your client who may not be quantitative, who has the domain expertise, who you've come to an agreement with about the problem and what you're doing and what the success will be? Well, can you come back with advice and explain, this is why this happened, this is why it's better? Is the solution intuitive or just magic? I mean, managers hate to commit to solutions they don't understand. They'd rather deal with bad solutions they do understand. Does this solution change everything? Just a wholesale change? Does it mean a whole organizational change? Whole sets of new computers? Throwing away data processing systems? Is this a fragile solution that lives a little pinpoint? Or is this a robust solution that's worldwide and global? What is the domain in which this solution provides? Or are there so many fragile simplifying assumptions that I can't move a micron in any direction without getting in trouble? Will the guy paying your bill still be in charge after this solution is put into effect? When you go into a place like Chevron and say, hey, we're going to centralize 93 dispatch centers to one, which means 92 you're going to be without a job, that's a tough one to brief. You better be careful. These are truck drivers. Moderation is a virtue. Sometimes it's much better, especially in DOD, to do a 50% solution that's executable than go for a 100% solution that you'll never get through committee. Okay, these solutions, if you're going to try this, the solutions have to be understandable. They have to be actionable, doable. They have to be legal. They have to be persistent. I'll explain this in a minute. They have to be monotonic. I'll explain this in a minute, Gary. They have to be robust. If your assumptions are wrong or change, your data is bad, in DOD, all data is bad. You're lucky if you've got one decimal place of precision. They have to be resilient. I'll explain this. Okay, for each, understandable. Good luck convincing a decision maker to adopt a policy that just he doesn't understand. He's not going to do it. You need to introduce a solution incrementally sometimes. You need to train up the client. Sometimes you need to demonstrate with many, many examples. Patience is a virtue. Actionable. It has to be in the domain of what's permitted. It has to be legal. Okay? You may be suggesting replacing another worthy problem by another harder problem. This is from a project we did for the Air Force in which we're launching satellites and we're launching boosters. We're scheduling about $30 billion worth of boosters and satellites for the next 25 years for the Air Force constellation. And what we discovered was our optimal solutions weren't actionable because we have to have continuous coverage of certain reconnaissance satellites. We have to have certain interactions between one decision and another decision. And so we discovered late on that we should have known things like concurrent dependence were a necessity. Prerequisite dependence, A before B has to happen, and contiguous dependence, I got to have a looker up there all the time, is also, we discovered this late in the game. And it made a big change to our briefing, big change to our solutions, and cost billions of dollars because it was a restriction. Non-intuitive answers are a challenge. You have to be very persuasive with that. We did a model of the Iraqi proliferation program to develop a first fission weapon. So we looked at everything you have to do from bare ground to a weapon. What does it take? It's a well-known problem in industrial engineering and physics. I mean, it's well published. Very clever techniques been around since 1946. We discovered that to interdict this project, we'd attack a task that was not on the critical path, which defies logic. That's not basic OR, is it? We always say, find the critical path and worry about it. Well, what we found with a non-critical task, which we hoped they weren't paying attention to, which if we could interdict, maximally delayed the completion of the first nuclear weapon. By the way, that non-critical task was, I can say this, it's unclassified, it was the availability of the metal hafnium, which comes from two places on Earth, both allies. Those places will not sell Iraq or its agents hafnium anymore. You got to be legal. I spend more time than I want to talking to JAGs and talking to attorneys. And you got to be within the bounds of what's in Title V and Title X and U.S. Code. It comes up more often than you like.
Sometimes things are done the way they're done because they have to be. Now let's talk about different things. This came up yesterday during one of the presentations, persistence. You can expect resistance if your solution is a fire drill. If your solution is change everything, you're going to have a lot of resistance. This is an example that we did for the U.S. Coast Guard. What we had was a quarterly schedule of these Coast Guard cutters. And each of these big deltas was a revision to that schedule that resulted from one of the cutters, the Sanibel, having a casualty and having to go into the yard for 3 weeks. So we re-optimized, quote unquote, the schedule. And look at this, for the next 90 days. It's a mess. That means people who were expecting to be home with their families weren't going to be. Vacations and plane tickets had to be canceled. I mean, it's a non-starter. So we developed a special set of models, which we call persistent models. Now, there's a paper on my homepage that explains these and how we've used them before. And with a persistent model, at very little cost increase, we were able to reduce those changes to these and demonstrate these were minimal changes. And the Coast Guard followed that advice. So that's a persistent solution. You're actually adding a feature that, in a sense, ways navigating by your wake. Don't change too much. Change what you can. How much change can you afford? Monotonic. Let me explain this in terms of budgeting and capital planning. Suppose you have a solution, and if I give you a little more money and a little more money and a little more money, these are the decisions that you get. With a little money, you buy A1. A little more money, you buy A1 and A2. Okay. A little more money, you buy A1 and B1. Huh? A little more money, A1, A2, A. Wait a minute. Okay. Those are optimal decisions. Happens all the time. Well, A1 may be Abrams tanks, and this may be an artillery piece, but it happens all the time. It happens with shipbuilding. Okay? This drives policy types crazy. It's not briefable. I mean, they're not going to take that to the Hill. How do you explain as I gradually have more and more money that suddenly I'm making wholesale changes in my portfolio? It's a non-starter. So what you want is a solution that is monotonic. So in this particular case, baseline case, and here what I'm showing is what happens if I was non-monotonic, I'm optimal, but what happens if I restrict myself to monotonicity so that as I increase money, I always maintain what I had bought before plus buy additional things, add to my bag of tricks, or if this is my base case, subtract from my bag of tricks. Gary Lazaro will tell you all about that. It's part of his dissertation. Okay, this is briefable. It's a restriction, and it doesn't save as much money as you'd like, but it's briefable. Okay, resilience. This has to do with the operating cost in terms of traffic in the San Francisco Bay Area, the bridges and roads of San Francisco Bay. And what we have across the bottom is a number of kinetic attacks by an intelligent adversary. And what we're modeling here is what can we do to harden this infrastructure, either by putting National Guard troops on the bridges to inspect vehicles, or by building secondary roads, or by doing things to tunnels that make them blast resistant. So what we have is the number of links that we're able to protect, let's say, with National Guard. So if I don't protect anybody, here's what happens when I get more and more attacks. Things get worse and worse and worse. If I have one company of National Guard for a short period of time, this is what happens. Two companies, three companies, four companies. So I'm pushing down the effectiveness that our attacker has on us. This is called resilience modeling. It's very important in infrastructure defense. It's very important because the U.S. does not use this yet in Department of Homeland Defense. The Department of Homeland Defense uses what's called probability risk assessment, which asserts that the terrorists are going to roll dice before they attack. That's not going to happen. We don't do that in DoD. We don't assume our enemy is going to roll dice. We assume our enemy is going to do the worst they can do, right? That's dictum, right? Robust. Here we have an optimal set of resilience results, and here's a set of resilience results you get by running simulations. So those of you that like simulations and say, gee, if I run 10,000 simulations, certainly I've done as good as I can do, you can see as problems get interesting and complex, you're not even close. Okay, let's talk about executive summaries, and you're going to take notes here because I need to hear if this works in N81, okay? In my limited experience, the best executive summary is 3 to 10 pages long. That's all the attention span the boss is going to have. Employs simple graphs with technical legends. If you're lucky, the general is going to look at the graphs, read the legends, get the whole story out of the legends, and then give it to a junior officer and say, I think this is worthy of you looking at, and get back to me. Maybe bring the author in. I want to talk to him. See and buy a copy of Scientific American or another magazine that's popular. It's called American Scientist. There are two different magazines. It's very aggressively edited. Notice the editorial trick. Pick an article about which you know nothing. Chromodynamics. Okay? Read the article. Notice how they use the eye candy and the legends to lead you through the whole story. That's the way to construct an executive summary. The best executive presentation is only 5 to 10 slides long, and a couple of those may be backup slides, just in case a hand goes up. You don't want to be waving your arms. You want to have prepared material to back yourself up. You want the slides numbered. And your slides aren't numbered, it's hopeless, it's a jumble. You have to have what I call a money slide. If I had to throw away all my slides and I just was allowed one slide left, what one slide would tell my whole story. Why I'm here, what I've done, the results, everything. Now that sounds like a tall order, but in every case I've ever been involved in, you can do it, can't you? I see some heads nodding. Yeah, you can. It takes some thought, but you want to do that thinking before you walk into the podium and not while you're standing at the podium, okay? There's a money slide. Now, this is a project that we did some years ago for the D.C. Metro System. The D.C. Metro System was going to be purchasing detectors to detect chembio attacks. And what we're trying to help them do is decide where to put these chembio detectors so that we got the earliest possible warning to the worst case attack. Because they have means of dealing with this, like reversing the exhaust blowers and so forth, and stopping the train, so you stop interactions of passengers between trains. So what we have here is the number of time in minutes to the first detection versus the number of detectors I can afford. These detectors are multi-million dollar devices. They're really big and you can't hide them. So the bad guys will know where they are. So no matter where you put the detectors, the bad guys, if they're smart, will try to introduce a contagion around those detectors to do bad things to you. So this is a series of bi-level optimizations that says no matter what happens, this is the worst that can happen. Where do I want to be here if this vertical scale is minutes and if this horizontal scale is in 6 times $2 million? Is that my decision to make? Or can I make the same description to you as the decision maker that I just gave the audience here and say, where do you want to be? The policymakers know where to put their finger on this screen. And once they say, I like that, that's the elbow I like, then you're in business. That's your money slide. I have to ask you again, why are you in OR? You like math? You like designing algorithms? You like puzzles? You like being called sir? Or do you want to influence policy? You're in this for policy. Thank you.